Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
We closed last week with a very simple but very significant question. And that is, do you have the testimony of Messiah? Now, probably most believers will say, yes, I do. Oh, I'm not perfect. I don't live all the time the way I should, but He's in me, and He is. But don't you want to live a life that's well-pleasing to Him? Don't you want to be someone who discerns the things of God, how God is functioning, what He's doing, the activity of God, and be right there to participate with it? Why? Because when you participate in the things of God, you're going to be experiencing intimacy with Him. Let me tell you, there is nothing better in this world than the intimacy of our Lord and Savior. Experiencing that, there's no greater joy. Well, once again, take out your Bible. We're in the midst of our study of the book of Revelation. We began chapter 19 last week, and let's press on. As I shared with you, we were talking about the testimony of Yeshua being in us, that our lives reflect Him. And the question I ask you is that a reality in your life? Well, at the end of verse 10, we see the aid, the truth, the reality to make that a truth in your life. So look with me once more. He speaks here about the people who have the testimony of Yeshua. And what do? We worship Him. Do you want to worship Him? Do you want to worship God and be faithful? It says, for the testimony of Yeshua. Here's the answer. If you want to have the testimony of Yeshua, notice what it is. It says, the testimony of Yeshua is the spirit of prophecy. Now, that truth is one that is all but going ignored by most believers today. I've said many, many times, by and large, the church is illiterate when it comes to prophecy. If you were to ask, what's the message of Joel? What's the message of Habakkuk? What's the message of Nahum? What are they trying to convey to those people who they were writing to? And what message is it for us today? Most believers do not know. And the reason why I know this is this. When I speak to a group and I say, let's open up to the book of Haggai, what happens? They don't open up and start finding in the middle of the book. They go to the table of context. They open up and try to find if there's a book named Haggai. We are prophetically illiterate. And if we're going to be found ready, if we're going to be people who are prepared like the bride of Messiah is called to be, then we need to understand prophetic truth. And that's why that 10th verse at the end there is so important. The testimony of Yeshua is the spirit of prophecy. That is, prophecy functions in the believer so that we give testimony of our faith and of our life in and through Yeshua. Well, let's press on to verse 11. Now, this is where there is a joyful scene. I mean, we've had the announcement of the wedding feast of the Lamb. But now we're beginning to see the events that will make this a reality. Look at verse 11. And I saw the heavens opening up, and behold, a white horse. Now, this is not the same one that was mentioned at the beginning of Revelation chapter 6. We see that's not Messiah. That is an embodiment of the false Messiah. For he is synonymous with death and Sheol. But this is, as we'll see, the true Messiah. Behold, a white horse, White has to do with a couple things. White has to do with purity, holiness, but it also has to do with victory. So the one who sat upon this white horse, and notice what he's called. He is called faithful and true. And here again, both of these words are uniquely related, faithfulness and truth. Faithfulness is the manifestation of the truth, and that's what it is. He is truth, and he manifests truth through his acts and through his identity. So it says, and the one who sat upon it, that white horse, he is called faithful and true. And in righteousness, he does something. In righteousness, now who are we talking about? Yeshua. And I hope everyone would agree. I mean, there are some very unique, and I would argue misguided, methods of interpreting and understanding the scripture. Yesterday, I was back in the States, and I was driving. I was listening to the radio, as I often do. I was listening to a man, J. Vernon McGee, passed on some 25 years ago. But someone who loved the scripture and dedicated his life to teaching through all the Word of God. And he was beginning a study of the book of Revelation, and he did so by saying how many different methods there are in interpreting the scripture, how many different understandings, and how people see some of it as already fulfilled, and I could go on and on. But I hope no matter how you interpret this book, I think we all would have to agree that when we come to Revelation chapter 19 and verse 11, it's something that has yet to be done. I mean, we're talking about Messiah coming, his second coming, to establish his kingdom. And notice what it says about him. He's coming to judge and what? And to make war. This is this man of grace. This is this compassionate one who was moved with compassion so often. But when he returns again, he's coming not to what? He's coming not to save, but he's coming to make war, to bring about God's judgment and the outcome of that judgment, which is the kingdom. Verse 12, and his eyes, just what we saw in Revelation chapter 1, his eyes were flames of fire, and upon his head were many crowns, so signifying that he's the King of Kings. And he has a name written upon him that no man is able to know except himself. Now, what is that a reference to? Well, if you do a good study, this name, this character that only he knows, this is an idiom. It is a saying that relates to himself as God. God who is what? Can really anyone understand God other than God? No. So this expression just announces, it reminds the reader, it teaches those who have not come to this conclusion that this one is indeed God Almighty. So once again, it says that he has eyes like a flame of fire, many crowns upon his head. He has a name written upon him that no man can know, only himself. Verse 13, and he is clothed in a garment dipped in blood. What does that signify? Redemption. He has a garment dipped in blood, and the name, his name that he is called by is the Word of God. Now, this term, the Word of God, scholars tell us that the Word of God is synonymous with the mind of God or the purpose of God. So what Scripture is referring to here is that this one's coming to fulfill the mind, the purpose, the plan of God. And what is that? The kingdom. That's what God always was about. If we look at God's creation, after God puts everything in order, what is its great outcome? The order of God's creation is seen in the Garden of Eden. And what happened there? Rebellion. And where the book of Revelation is going now, Messiah is coming to establish that kingdom. And we're going to see in chapter 21, the relationship between the kingdom in its final state, what the Bible calls the New Jerusalem, and its connection to the Garden of Eden. So what I want you to see here is that Messiah Yeshua, he brings about the plan, the purpose, the mind of God. And that's why he's called the Word of God, verse 14. And the armies of heaven went forth after him upon white horses, and they were clothed in garments of fine linen, white and pure, verse 15. And from his mouth goes forth a sharp sword. And what does he do? He strikes the nations. But here again, that's that same word that refers to those of any background, from any ethnic group, that does not have a covenantal relationship with God. If you were to ask me, what is the most precious thing that I possess? The most precious thing that I possess is a covenantal relationship with God. And as we've talked about, that covenant is the new covenant, and new is synonymous with the kingdom. It's a kingdom covenant. So once more, look at this text. The armies of God go forth after him upon white horses. They were clothed in linen garments, white and pure, verse 15. And a sword, a sharp double-edged sword, goes out to strike the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. Now, we're in Revelation chapter 19. And in Revelation chapter 20, we're going to see a kingdom, the millennial kingdom. And there he's ruling with the rod of iron, which means this: he tolerates no sin. We need to see that there is a major distinction between the millennial kingdom of Revelation 20 and the New Jerusalem, that final kingdom, in Revelation 21 and 22. So here, when he's ruling with the rod of iron, we're going to see it's a reference to maintaining righteousness, the righteousness of God's character. And where is that character manifested to us? In the commandments of God. Now here again, we're not saved by the commandments of God. But when we look at the millennial kingdom, the righteousness of the law is going to be manifested. Why is that? Because we're going to see in that millennial kingdom 1,000 years of God's righteous rule, a rule that reflects his character. And the commandments of God manifest to us the character of God. What did I mean by that? If God were to become a man, and by the way, he did, and he was to live in this world, and he did, he would obey the law. He would not be a violator of the law, and he didn't. And that's why he was sinless, and that's how he could be the atonement, the redeemer of all humanity, all those who call upon his name. So look at the end of verse 15, and he will rule them with a rod of iron, and he will tread upon the winepress of the wrath, the hot or fearless wrath of the God of hosts, or the God of armies. So we're in Revelation 19. We're seeing Messiah come. And he comes how? He comes in the aspect of judgment. Now, I mentioned that his garment, the scripture does, was a garment dripped in blood. And I associated that with redemption, and rightly so. But we also have to see the rabbis talk about the fact that the Torah has 70 facets. 70 panim shaTorah. 70 facets of the Torah. And what is very, very significant is this. When you look, and facets come from like the word diamond. When you look at a diamond from different perspectives, you're seeing the same diamond, but different things are manifested. Same thing with the law and all of Scripture. This idea of the blood being upon his garments don't always speak to him being redeemer, but also his judgment. Why do I say that? Because if you look at the book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 63, it talks about this one. It's a clear reference. There's no disagreement among the scholars, either Jewish or Christian, that this is a reference to Messiah. And he comes out of Batsra. He comes where he judges Mount Seir, or Edom. And this blood soiled his garment because it was the blood of judgment. And that's what we have a reference to here. Look again at verse 15. And he treads upon the winepress of the fierceness of his wrath. Whose wrath? The God of hosts, heavenly hosts, the armies. And upon his garment and upon his thigh. Now, here again, we have to understand the culture. The thigh was a place, today we shake hands, shake on it, we'll make a deal. But in biblical times, they grabbed the thigh. So when it says here that upon his garment and upon his thigh, it shows faithfulness. It shows that which is believable. And what does it say? Is written the name. What's that name? The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Here a reference to rule. It is a call to receive him and to receive his authority. That's what faith is all about. Submitting to the authority of God. Well, press on, verse 17. And I saw one angel standing in the sun. Now, standing in the sun, that is impossible from a natural perspective. And the reason why that's there is to tell us what the kingdom of God is like. It is unbelievable. It is not natural. It is supernatural. So verse 17, I looked and one angel standing in the sun, and he cried out in a great voice and said to every bird that has a wing, who is what? Who flies in the utmost part of the heavens. And this angel says, come and gather yourself for the banquet of the great God, or the great banquet of God, depending upon how you translate that. So here again, bird, well, where's that a reference to? Think about the battle between David and Goliath. What did David say? David says, you know, the birds aren't going to eat my flesh, but they're going to eat your flesh, Goliath or Goliath. It is a image of shame. Birds coming and eating the carcasses of something, it is repulsive. It has a stench. It is simply that which is shameful. And that's what the end of this world's going to be, those who are not part of the kingdom of God. So once again, we see a reference to Messiah coming, not just to come as this bridegroom and this intimacy that comes about. For that to become a reality, what's still emphasized here is this judgment, this war. He comes to make war, and now he's victorious, and the birds are coming to eat up the carcasses of those who did not know redemption. Once again, verse 17, and I looked, and one angel standing in the sun. That's also, one scholar said, sun has to do with illumination. Believe this. This is tested. God is shining his light upon it so we see it correctly. He cried out with a great voice, and he said to every bird with a wing that flies in the midst of the heaven, come and gather yourself for the banquet of the great God. And you shall eat, verse 18, you shall eat the flesh of the kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and those who sat upon them, and the flesh of every man, free man, and every slave, both small and great. Now, what's it telling here? Well, God is not a respecter of persons. It doesn't matter who you are, whether you're great or not so great, whether you're rich or poor, makes no difference. The only way that one can escape this judgment is through faith, through siding with, accepting the gospel, believing in Messiah Yeshua, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, making him the Lord of your life. So we find in this passage of Scripture, verse 19, and I looked, and the beasts and the kings of the earth and their armies, they were all assembled to make war with the one who rides upon this horse and his armies. Now, what do we find? We find that at this late moment, I mean, after all the judgments, all the trumpet judgments in Revelation chapter 8 and 9, all the bold judgments in Revelation chapter 16, all the great judgments in Revelation chapter 18 and now 19, the end has already been written. It is clear. And what happens? Look again. We see in this passage that those beasts, that empire, the kings of the earth, all their armies, they gathered what? To make war with this one who rides upon the white horse and his armies. They are eternally rebellious. They cannot be brought to submissiveness. And that's why they're going to receive that eternal judgment. Verse 20. And the beast was seized, and that false prophet with her, which made signs before her, which deceived those who took the mark of the beast and bowed down to the image. They were cast alive. Now, this expression, they were cast alive, it doesn't mean they were alive when they threw in and then they soon died thereafter. The context of the grammar here means that they were cast alive and they remained alive in what's known as this torment. They were cast alive, both of them, into this lake that burns with fire and sulfur. And the remaining of the ones, all those who were part of them, they were killed with that sword that went forth from the mouth of the one who rode upon the horse. Now, it's very significant that this sword goes from his mouth. Remember in the scripture, Messiah is speaking and he says, "Do not think that I came to bring peace." And this word peace means just the absence of violence. That's not why he came. He didn't come to bring about Shangri-La in the sense of everything fine and dandy, no violence, everyone just does what he wants, but there's no conflict. That's not why he came. In fact, he says, "I came to bring war." And he says in another place, "I came bringing a sword." Now, what does a sword do? A sword divides. It puts things in two groups. And that's what we see here. Remember that teaching about separating the sheep from the goats? Same principle here. And what we find in this scripture is the one who comes, he is going to destroy those with what? Well, if you look at that scripture that speaks about him bringing not peace, but a sword. You know what that sword is? It's the gospel. The gospel is either going to give life or it's going to be the source of judgment. When you reject the grace of God, and that's what the gospel is all about. When you reject the grace of God, what you are doing is inviting that sword that brings about eternal death to come and strike and plummet through you. And that's why Messiah, that sword, that instrument of death, is coming from his mouth. He gives words of life, but when you reject that life, you will receive eternal death. Once again, verse 21, "And those who remain, they were killed with the sword that went forth from his mouth, from the one who rode upon the horse, and every bird was satisfied," that is, they were filled with their flesh. Now, why does the term flesh appear here? Very simple. Flesh is synonymous with sin. In this context, flesh is synonymous with that carnal nature. And let me conclude this ninth chapter by going back to something that we learned previously, and that is circumcision. What did we learn about circumcision? Circumcision is the death of the flesh. And your flesh is going to die. If you're wise, you will experience the death of the flesh through circumcision. When is circumcision? Eighth day. It is a death that brings about eight, a new beginning. Eight, redemption. Eight, the kingdom. You will experience the death of that carnal nature. But if you don't understand that, you don't experience that, you're careless with that, you're going to be like Moses, who failed to circumcise his son in the context of redemption. And what happens? Death visited him. Same thing with the gospel. The gospel is like that sword of circumcision. Why? It cuts. It divides. See, it is going to either kill your carnal nature or it's going to pierce you. There's no position in between. What we need to understand is that circumcision is a covenant. We don't say circumcision, we say Brit Milah, the covenant of circumcision. Usually it's not translated when the phrase circumcision appears in English, it leaves off that word, covenant of circumcision. But circumcision is a covenant. It's agreement with God. It manifests the death of the flesh. And what the gospel does is that it circumcised not our physical body, but it circumcised our heart. It gives us a new heart. A heart with what? A heart without that evil inclination. It brings death to our heart that we might receive a new heart. A heart of what? Not a heart of stone, but it uses the term here, a heart of flesh. In this case, flesh is being used as life. A heart that can feel. Feel what? Is sensitive to the things of God. So let me conclude and just simply ask you, have you experienced the circumcision of your heart? Because that sword that comes forth from Messiah, it is going to do one of two things. It is going to be used to kill that evil inclination, that carnal nature that rules the heart of an unredeemed person. Or, if it does not, that sword is going to be used to bring everlasting death, as we see at the end of Revelation 19. Well, it ends, this 19th chapter of the book of Revelation ends with a banquet for these unclean birds. But Revelation 20 begins, and notice the contrast. Either a banquet of dead flesh or a marriage banquet, which is synonymous with the kingdom that we're going to talk about when we enter into Revelation chapter 20 next week. Well, I'm out of time. Until that next week, and we begin speaking about the millennial kingdom.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with Him. Shalom from Israel.